face and look for the shark fins. It's a new shark, you get to put your little code on it, boom, you get your new shark. If it's a one that's already been seen, you then put that into its file so you know which date it's been seen on. They've only been doing it for a year, you've already got over 153 individual sharks. Pretty cracking. Now, these were probably the best, some of the best days in Africa. My first white shark was seen on one of these boats. And what they did is they went, there you go, Donovan, there's a smooth hound. White sharks eat smooth hounds, might I just add. So I then go walking over to the side of the boat, about to launch this smooth hound, I look down, there's a great white shark like. And I just went, do I stick it in? They went, no. Like, it had one of these plastic tags on, and the great white was like, come on, I want food. It swam around the boat for like 2 minutes. I looked at the smooth hound, and the smooth hound went, don't you dare. We shook the smooth hound in after like 3 minutes. The white shark went, oh, where's it gone? And I've never seen a shark disappear so fast in my entire life. Poof, gone. On this boat, we went on a sunset fishing trip. We had dolphins and seals around the boat fishing. We had birds, we had sharks, we had great whites as well. And there's all sorts, even just from the research boat. And the best thing about the research vessel, it wasn't even that big. From the swordfish rostrums about here is the length of shark bait, their fishing vessel. And great whites prefer smaller boats. So they all the great whites came off the big white shark diving boat and came straight to us. So we were there going, like, there's all the tourists are like that, looking at us like, we paid so many hundreds of minutes, like, we're here with white sharks, mate. So it was absolutely fantastic. So the process with white shark, with the small sharks, you remove them from the water, we measure them, we tag them, and put them back. Simple as. We take a few pictures as well for our database as well. The whole process takes 2 to 3 minutes, unless we want to get a quick picture with our shark as we're lifting it into the water, and that too. So the sharks have very little stress put on them, they're out the water for very little time, and it was for a good purpose as well. And the reason why this study was being done is because of the fact that white sharks eat small sharks, and without small sharks, baby white sharks wouldn't be able to survive very long. So they're doing a study to determine how many small sharks are left around South Africa. Shark safe barrier, I mentioned before. People don't like to go in the ocean with sharks, so people have been trying to do shark nets. Shark nets up the east coast of South Africa killed 1,000 white sharks since 1975 to the mid-2010s, killed 1,000 white sharks. Now, seeing as there's up to 523 white sharks left in South Africa alone, it's a lot of white sharks. So, Sarah Andriotti and Michael Rupton have been setting up these hollow pipes with magnets in to try and deter large predatory sharks from the shores. They're very eco-friendly, and so far, it's had a 100% success rate. So, pretty good, in my opinion. They're eco-friendly because there's no risk of entanglement, whereas the nets that are being used at the east coast of South Africa, the sharks get tangled, and they're very useless as well because most sharks that get caught are caught on the inside of the net where people are swimming. So these nets actually trap sharks against the shore where you're swimming. So they're not shark-safe nets, they're just nets, essentially. And they catch everything. They catch whales, turtles, birds, everything. They catch it. So it's pretty bad. Right. You've all heard about this on the news. The 5th, we were notified about a female white shark washing up as we were about to go on our first fishing trip. It was the first day I arrived, we had a barbecue with beers. Second day, we had our lecture day, so we were introduced to the whole place, stuff like that, and then my girlfriend's looking at me really like, what the hell, face? Yeah, her name is Felicity, leave me alone. Oh, yeah, sorry, my date's the wrong way around. Late night. So, we were talking about it on the 4th, and on the 5th, she was dissected. She was a 3 firsts in 1, which is quite incredible. She was the biggest white shark to ever be dissected in South Africa. She was the first recorded orca and white shark interaction in South Africa, ever. Because if you remember, I asked on my first day, and they went, no, it's never happened. Then this happened. And she was the first white shark to be dissected after an orca attack in scientific history. So she was 3 firsts in 1. Pretty incredible. And details of it, there she is. Dissection was done under the supervision of the DEA due to the fact that they are a protected species and they are worth a lot, their products from them is worth a lot of money. Total length was 4.9 metres, dorsal height was 0.5 metre, pectoral weight was 18.27 on its own. The jaw was 0.5 metres, so 0.5 metre wide, 1 metre tall. So she was quite a big animal. She was 1,100 kilos minus her liver. Bear in mind, a shark's liver is 1/3 of its body weight. Quite a heavy animal. So that's how big she was. Yeah, Jesus. When I rolled up like that, I went, oh my God. Now bear in mind, this is my first white shark in the flesh. So my first white shark ever was dead. Now, this hole you can see on her chest was 30 centimetres wide, and that's one of her fins being weighed. I'll talk more about that injury in a second. And there she is. That's how many people it takes to roll a 4.9 metre white shark. I had her head end, and literally she weighed the same as my drunk friend trying to kick him off the ground. Like, so heavy. I had shark rash all over my fingers, rolling it, all the skin on my hands were gone, because of course, as you know, sharks have very rough skin, so trying to roll that is pretty, really hard to do. And there's her jaw being dissected. I got to help with that, so I was very pleased. And there's her teeth as well. Unfortunately, throughout the night, so she was pulled out of the show, she brought to Marine Dynamics Lab the day before the dissection. She sat on the badminton court. I expected the dissection to happen in a lab. It didn't, it happened on a badminton court. And in the night, some people snuck onto the ground and stole quite a few of her teeth. And her teeth are worth quite a lot of money. Her jaw on its own was calculated to be worth about $100,000 on the black market. So a crazy amount of money. Now, just as a cool fact for you, when I went to South Africa the day before, there was a running joke in work that I was going to fist a white shark and that I was going to grab a male white shark by its claspers, and I did both. Because when we were sat at the dissection, someone went, "It's a virgin." And I went, "It's a virgin?" At 4.9 metres. They went, "Yeah, do you want to feel?" And I went, "Yeah." Stuck my hand in, didn't think, had no gloves on whatsoever, felt the hymen, pulled out, went, "Shit." Needless to say, I was picking shark poo out from underneath my fingernails for 5 days. And I scrubbed those. I'm sorry, I wore gloves to eat, don't worry. But the smell was unreal. But unfortunately, the night of that dissection, oh, sorry, there's her liver missing. So usually when you dissect the shark, the first thing that pours out is its liver. That's what was inside of her when they cut her open. No liver whatsoever. So as soon as that happened, they then knew orcas did it. And they just went, "Hey, orcas!" And I went, "How about no, not orcas?" So the running joke in South Africa when this happened was... a bit of Hannibal action going on. So just to give you guys a bit of an insight to how orcas, they believed the orcas were doing it, is they were swimming in, nutting the white shark straight to the side of the head, and then because it was two males that were doing it, they either theorised that they were grabbing them by the chest and pulling the chest off, and then the liver, because it's buoyant, simply flows out of this hole, and then they snip it off. The white shark was still alive when its liver was taken away because its heart was full of sand. So they know that as the heart was beating, it sucked sand into the blood vessels and into the heart, which was a final insult to injury. Or, the second theory, which I prefer, headbutt. One orca comes either side of the white shark, they grab it by its pectoral fins and yank outwards, pulling the chest cavity in half, pulling it open, and then sucking its liver out. Pretty gruesome, pretty effective, pretty smart. You've got to give them credit, they are quite a big animal, but to fight a white shark is very high risk, is a very high risk hunt, so for them to go against it is quite good. I'll wrap up soon, don't worry, I know I'm getting close to the end of my time. The other white sharks, there's the male, that's all that was left of him, by the way, after he was cut up. We got to this dissection the next day, I forgot to mention, the night of the first dissection, we sat in a volunteer house eating pizza and watching Racing Extinction for the first time. And Imke, the research assistant, goes, "Jesus!" And I went, What's happened? And she goes, "Another white shark just washed up." So the night of that dissection, another white shark washed up on shore. And this was a male. He was a little bit smaller, it was 3.5 metres. But there was virtually nothing of him left. So yeah, pretty sad to be honest. And I got to pick up the claspers. The claspers of this thing were about that long. Absolutely huge. He was a mature male, whereas the female was either a virgin or immature. We're not quite sure. So that was him. There was the white shark that washed up 1.5 hours down the coast, 5 days after this one. So the orcas went on a true killing spree. And we didn't have any more dead white sharks wash up after him for about 4 weeks. And we had the white sharks come back. And I was like, "Oh my God, the white shark's back, yeah!" And as the white sharks were really starting to come back, really kick off again, really get back into their action, the two killers came back and went, "We're going to mess this up for you now again." And it folded away. And that's all that's left of him. So he was a nearly 4 metre long white shark. I got to help out with the dissection of him and the first one, which was really quite cool, but there was virtually nothing of him left. In these two, it wasn't just their livers. In all of the white sharks, all the livers were missing, but in these two, it wasn't just the liver, it was their heart and their testicles as well. So yeah, they like to go around castrating white sharks. So I'm going to show you a video. I am really behind. I'm so sorry. No, 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 no! Wrong thing to do. Where have I gone? Sorry, guys, just bear me 1 second. I had it up ready to go.
I have to hit watch this one more time.
You have to. Kieran and Richard have to hear this at work every day. Is this it? No, that's not it. No, 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 no. Sorry, guys, I've showed you the wrong video. Why is it gone? There it is. Sorry. My mistake. I was running. It's still black. Shell when there weren't orcas ripping great whites apart. But yeah, So, on to the last part of the talk. Sorry guys, I know your bums are all hurting, you probably want to go for a beer. So we'll wrap up the last part of the presentation now. So, I've told you all about sharks being killed by people and stuff like that, and how people can help protect sharks. There is still hope with sharks, so people are realising that sharks are not nasty animals. As I mentioned in the beginning, in the last 9 years of working in the aquarium, I have seen this change happen, and it's really quite an incredible thing to see with people. It goes to show that people's minds can be changed. The amount of times that we've had people come do shark dives, and they come over to the side and you go, "Are you okay?" And they go, they get in, they come out, and they're like, "That was great." And we go, "Told you," like that, and it's fantastic. And that's what needs to happen. We just need more people to see sharks in the natural habitat, to dive for sharks, to see them, experience them. And people will realise, same as dolphins at Discovery Cove, although I know a few people might not agree with that, it can change people's minds. It can make people realise that they are not nasty creatures. Stronger laws, regulations are now being put on sharks. So for example, pressure sharks are now a protected species under CITES Appendix 2, which happened only a few days ago, which is really fantastic to see. Recent news, there you go, as I just mentioned, pressure sharks are protected under CITES Appendix 2. Should have put a space under, a space between under and CITES, unfortunately. Appendix 2 since CITES conference on October the 5th. So there you are, nice pretty pressure shark, it's not that fine. Divers sighted a megamouth shark underwater in the Komodo National Park. Who saw that video? I shared it like 3 times on Facebook. Okay, there's a few people. You guys have no idea how rare it is to see that, because I think they've only been sighted 9 times alive since their discovery in 1973. So they're an incredibly rare animal to see alive underwater. And again, about megamouth sharks, megamouth was caught in Japan, placed into a sea pen the next day, died the next day. Same as the great white last year in the aquarium. What is it with them? They're moving out into the ocean. Last bits. Yeah, it's cute, isn't it? So things to look at. Shark Trust. Just to let you all know, Shark Trust and Fighters. Yes, we have got 2 money boxes down here at the front. If you'd like to donate some of your pennies, that would be greatly appreciated. I will be sticking some pennies in as well. So they're the 2 money boxes behind the shark jaw just there. So if you'd like to just donate some pennies, that would be greatly appreciated. Fin Fighters, they don't really, should have just done the next one. Spikeback Conservation is another thing, really good thing to look at as well. Marine Conservation Society, Racing Extinction, watch it, go home and watch it this week. And Shark Alliance as well, they're all fantastic organisations to go and look at for shark conservation, more information, stuff like that. And finally, thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah, so just a couple of the events that are coming up this weekend and the coming weeks. The Marine Mammal Society are running a Sea Watch survey on Saturday, so make sure you get involved with that. So go do some Marine Mammal survey in. I think though, are you arranging transport out there?
We are trying to get a minibus.
Okay.
Yes, you. Minibuses.
Yeah, difficult to give a lot of experience in the room, yeah. But yeah, if you follow them on Facebook, have a look at the event to find out about the details for that, make sure you go along. And we'll be running a Puffin Island boat trip on Saturday the 21st of October, so next Saturday. We'll be meeting at Beaumaris Pier at 1:30, and it's a 90-minute boat trip with the Sea Coast Safari Company, if anyone's heard of it. We'll be going around Puffin Island, a chance to see loads of marine mammals and seabirds, and the trip will